ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
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 ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय। ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय।
ॐ नमः शिवाय ॐ नमः शिवाय
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 ॐ नमः शिवाय ॐ नमः शिवाय हय नमः पार्वतीपतये हर हर महादेव हरि ओम वी हैव चोजन दिस वंडरफुल प्लेस फॉर दिस रिट्रीट द टेक्स्ट चोजन फॉर दिस ऑल्सो इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड वेरी ब्यूटिफुल Patanjali Yoga Sutra. That way we have four chapters in this Yoga Sutra, but we will be taking only the first chapter, which is the essence of the entire Yoga Sutra. If you can understand and follow that first chapter, that itself will be sufficient. We have so many spiritual literature. The most ancient are our Vedas, which are the most amazing spiritual literature in the world. It's the most ancient. Nowhere in this world we have anything more ancient than this. Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, Atharva Veda. But apart from this Vedas, we also have what we call the Puranas, then the Itihas like the Mahabharata, Ramayana, and other texts which are helpful in understanding Vyakarana, Jyotisha, then Dhanurveda and Stapatya Veda and all those things, architecture and all. But apart from this, we have what we call the Darshan Shastra. It's the most amazing thing which our rishis have given. The Vedas are there, but from the Vedas and from their own experience, the rishis have given us what we call Darshan. Darshan literally means to see. They have given us ability to see. See what? See ourselves, see the world, and see God. They have given us few visions of seeing. Because the main funda, the main fundamental concept is that yatha drishti, tatha srishti. That as your vision, so is your world or so is your experience. That is the most fundamental thing. The rishi says that your vision determines the world and your experience. Worldly people think that the world determines my experience. It is not really the world which determines what type of experience I will have, good or bad. It is my vision which determines the good and bad experience. And this is everyone's experience also, that situation remaining same, 10 people, let us say, facing same situation or similar situation will experience 10 different things. And very famous example is there in our Ramayana. When Ramchandra ji was told that you will be given the kingdom tomorrow, special program Rajyabhishek, he was pleased. He was very happy also that yes, my father chose me, and I can have this opportunity to serve my people. But next day he was again called emergency meeting. he was told that some change in plan, that instead of kingdom, you will have to go to the forest. Not for 1 or 2 days, not for retreat like. But you will have to go for 14 years. And not with all the princely facilities, but you will have to wear the dress of a hermit and go and live life in the forest for 14 years without entering a city. And then after that you can come back. And why? Because the mother Kaikeyi felt like that. Whatever her reasons. So when Ramchandraji heard about this, again there was no depression or no change in his feelings. Even Tulsidasji describes that when he heard about it, there was no change in his expression. That prasannata had not dropped even a little bit. People saw him entering the palace, very prasanna, very with great peace and joy, and he came out, walked out, same peace and joy was there, not a trace of depression or dejection or sadness. So later on somebody asked him that how come you could maintain this balance? Because generally we don't, if somebody even promises that aaj party ke liye aa jana, last minute if they say thoda cancel ho gaya party, whole day I am upvas kar liya and I wanted to, I looking forward for that, you feel irritated. But here the kingdom was offered and taken back. So somebody asked him that what is your vision of life, how could you maintain that balance. He said that when I heard about this, that I was given this kingdom of forest, he said that is also kingdom to me. And I immediately thought the great opportunity I will get of meeting the holy people, the rishis who are staying in the forest, and the great opportunity I will get of listening to them and being in their company and serving them. That is one thing. Another, that I will be obeying the words of my parents. It is a great opportunity for me that they have chosen me and they have spoken to me, they have told me to do this and I will do it. It's a great thing. So he was very happy. Deeply happy. Why he was happy? Because of his vision. Situation is same. If another person was there, he would have been depressed. So the rishis says that you don't try to change the world. World will have its own rules and regulation, and it is controlled by so many factors. You will not be able to change the world at will. We may keep on trying, but it doesn't. Even Dasharath Maharaj wanted Ramchandraji to become the king. And the great king like Dasharath Maharaj, whatever he decides, he could do it. But he could not do this. It was beyond his control what happened. And that can, anybody can change the plan of a person. Manthara sitting there, she changed the whole plan. She rewrote the script. But Ramchandraji, whatever be the situation, he had learned to remain calm, peaceful and happy. Why? Because he had a wonderful vision, what we call darshan of life. So that is what the rishis have given us. There are 6 very famous or very traditional visions which the rishis have given, which are called Shad Darshan. And later on also many great Mahatmas have come. They have also given their vision. So we have what we call the traditional darshanas like the Vaisheshik, Nyaya, Sankhya, Yoga, Purva Mimamsa, Uttar Mimamsa. These are the six traditional darshanas. Apart from that, we have Charvak Darshan, we have Bauddha Darshan, we have Jaina Darshan, Indian I am talking about. So this, when we study this vision of these great rishis who have given us these darshanas, we adopt it in our life, we will be able to deal with the various ups and downs which comes in our life. We will be able to also eliminate what we really want to eliminate permanently, and that is our sorrow. The main thing which is troubling all humanity, in fact all beings, are sorrow, suffering. Suffering is there. Darshanas help us to deal with this suffering. Even religions, they give various reasons and various ways of looking at it. Even like Christianity, Islam, or other religions also, if suffering is there, they tell us how to look at it. You can consider it as a gift of God or whatever. Various darshanas are there, which help us to deal with it. I remember when I was in America, I was called to a medical university, and various other spiritual leaders were also there from different faith. Jew and Christians and Buddhist and all, Islam. So we were given one question. One of the question, important question, is how do you or your religion look at suffering and death? Because they wanted us to speak to the doctors and who were dealing with not only people who were suffering, but also those who were near death or what you call fatal illnesses, and they had to face death. Because they found that their faith determines how they deal with it. Disease remaining same, people from different faith face it differently. Some are quite cheerful about it. Some become totally hyper. Depends on what type of vision we have towards it. It's very interesting. So all of us, we want to be free of our sorrows or suffering. Atyantika dukkha nivritti. Dukkha nivritti means freedom from dukkha. And really what we want is atyantika dukkha nivritti, means completely free from sorrow we want to be. Freedom from sorrow completely. That is one thing. And another thing we, as a bonus if we can get, is Paramananda Prapti. If suppose two things are there, happiness and sorrow, freedom from sorrow and getting happiness, we will prefer dukkha to chhod do. One beggar came to someone's house for asking for something. And then the dog started barking and chasing him. He said, please don't give me anything, but please control your dog. Many people are there. If you cannot give me joy, it's fine, but don't give me sorrow. Even from our own children sometimes we tell. Ki baba, apna rakh do apne paas, don't trouble me. You need not give me joy, but don't give me sorrow. So freedom from sorrow is the first thing which we want. And then, if we can get permanent happiness, that is something most wonderful. So our great thinkers of the past, they thought about this only, and they all of them, many of them gave this vision, different visions. So whether it is what you call Vaisheshik philosophy, or Nyaya, or Sankhya, Yoga, Purva Mimamsa, Uttar Mimamsa, they have given us the vision. If you hold on to this understanding of yourself, the world, and God, if you have this particular understanding, then you will be able to deal with the sorrows. It will not give you that sorrow, and you will get happiness. Some of the philosophies or the vision promised that you will become free completely of sorrow, and you will get permanent happiness. Even Charvak philosophy, which is a materialistic philosophy, they also, the main aim is to become free of sorrow, which many people adopt it. Free of sorrow and some joy. But that freedom from sorrow also becomes, as Anand said, freedom from sorrow also becomes temporary, and joy also becomes temporary. So it is not really a good thing. So this traditional darshanas which we have, six darshanas, they are like the six possible good vision which we can have. They are like mathematics. You cannot have 7, 8, 9. They are actually, these six are good possible vision which can we can have to face the various ups and downs of our life. So most of us are studying what we call the Vedantic Vedanta Darshan. Many of you are expert in Vedanta Darshan, which is given to us by whom? Ved Vyas. Ved Vyas ji has given the Vedanta Darshan, which is based on the Upanishad, which are the end portion of the Vedas. Based on those Upanishad, Ved Vyas ji, he came up with this Vedanta Darshan, and he gave that darshan in 555 sutras, which we call the Brahma Sutra. Athato Brahma Jidnyasa Janmadyasya Yataha. And so on. This 555 sutras are there, which tells us that if you study the, listen to the Vedas, the Upanishads, Shravan, then contemplate on it and meditate on it, you will be able to recognize your real nature as Brahma. And once you recognize yourself as Brahma, and once you know this whole world is just an illusion, you will become free of all sorrow and will gain permanent happiness. We also have this Purva Mimamsa given by Jaimini Rishi, which is based on the initial portions of the Vedas, and which talks about Karma Kanda, which says that if you perform various types of rituals in a particular way, you will become free of sorrow. And later on you can also get nice swarga and all, and will be very happy there. Others will say, oh, swargavasi ho gaye. So there are this karma kanda, or that darshan, Mimamsa, Purva Mimamsa it is called. Then we have that Vaisheshik and Nyaya. But we will be studying here the Yoga Darshan. It is a different darshan than Vedanta. So those who have been studying Vedanta for a long time, they might find it that lot of terms are there which are new or which are differently defined. which are defined differently. So you have to keep aside your Vedantic thing little bit and try to understand the Yoga Darshan from the Yoga Darshan standpoint only, because it's a different vision is being given. It's like you want to look at the moon. One person is looking from the, let us say, from a high, tall mountain. Another person is at some other place and looking at the moon. Their vision, both of them are looking at the moon, but it is different. Similarly, this Yoga Darshan is a different, what you call that, darshan altogether, and which is also based on Sankhya. So Sankhya and Yoga go together. So we will also try to understand this Sankhya, and then we will be able to comprehend this Yoga. In fact, it is the most ancient philosophy or the darshan of our India. Much the oldest is the Sankhya, and then came the Yoga. And the importance of Sankhya and Yoga is mentioned very much in Bhagavad Gita and also in other texts. Bhagavan Krishna talks a lot of Sankhya and Yoga. Yoga, that word has become so famous. So we will try to understand in these few days the Yoga Darshan, and as a support for that Yoga Darshan, we will also try to understand the Sankhya on which it is based. So this Yoga, actually Sankhya is like a theory and Yoga is like practice. Sankhya will tell you what, how, where, what is the main structure of it. From tomorrow morning I will start, so now I will just go round and round. And Yoga is the technique by which we can experience or directly get established in the truth revealed in Sankhya. And I tell you, it's the most fascinating, this darshana, this Yoga Darshan. And Patanjali Rishi, who has given us this in a sutra form, is the most scientific. He was the first great psychologist, you can say, and a great master. And he has given us this darshan in a most scientific way. It's like mathematics. It's like mathematics. 2 + 2 = 4 means there you cannot have anything else. You cannot say 2 + 2 = 5 in our, according to me it is 5, according to me it is 10. No, it is precise. Therefore, that it is based on Sankhya, which also means Sankhya. Sankhya means number. It is, many things are mentioned as number only. How many, this Purusha is there, Prakriti, how many of them are there? Numbers are mentioned. Also, number means it is more precise. Samyak. Kya means to know or knowledge, precise knowledge, proper knowledge. And Yoga, systematic technique of contemplation and meditation and recognizing it. Because after studying everything, whatever theory we study, the ultimate the fall of all the theory is to then experience what is said. It's like somebody describing in detail gulab jamun. Ki what are the different types of gulab jamuns are there? And what is the best gulab jamun? And how it should be made? How it should be eaten? If it is warm, it is nice. Fresh, warm. You can, how it should be held in your hand and smell. If you talk about it for even 10 hours, in fact 10 hours will be too much, even for few hours, people will get exhausted actually. They will say, Are Baba, haath mein de do. Kitna bologe aap? Similarly, if we listen to the Upanishads and everything that you are that Brahma, again we go back with a sad face only. Even whether we hear it for 1 hour or whether we hear it for 1 year or 10 years, it doesn't make any difference in our life if it is not directly experienced. It doesn't matter whether the rishis have experience or teacher has experience. Unless I have experienced it, it makes no difference for me. So yoga is a technique by which we can directly experience that state of enlightenment, what the Sankhya is pointing out or what the Vedanta is talking about, can be experienced by following the systematic technique of this yoga. Yoga, one meaning of yoga is to join, to yoke. So we can join or we can reunite with our own supreme nature. At present we are as though dealing from ourselves, but with the help of this yogic technique we will join to that nature. In this first chapter which we will study is called the Samadhipad. There are only 51 sutras, and in these 51 sutras very systematically Patanjali Rishi gives us the technique. It's most amazing. I have not seen anything more amazing than this. Mind-blowing, as they say, literally. It means the mind is blown off. Mind gets blown off. So I am warning you that after the camp you will have to go home without your mind. People might be saying same thing now also to you, to mindless, eh? But later on it will become a fact. So we will study this text. We will start from tomorrow morning, 7:30 to 8:45 we'll have the first class. So I invoke the blessings of Pujya Gurudev, whose blessings are always on us. Pujya Guruji, who has always been very kind, and whatever I am teaching actually I have learned from him. And I invoke the blessings of all the great masters, even including Patanjali Maharaj. I invoke the blessings of all these devatas to make this camp successful in all ways. So let us conclude with a prayer.
श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम्।